He claims he's a harmless victim.
I ask all of you to wait and hear the truth before you label or condemn me.
Others say he's a dangerous predator.
An arrest warrant for Mr. Jackson has been issued on multiple counts of child molestation.
While the question of Michael Jackson's guilt or innocence is furiously debated, he remains seemingly unfazed.
Do you want more children?
Yes.
Despite accusations and indictments, this self-proclaimed king continues to rule a world where the bizarre is commonplace and truth is lost in a cloud of fantasy. How is it possible that a middle-aged man can make such a profound break with reality and be so oblivious to the storm surrounding him? The answers may lie in Michael Jackson's secret childhood. In this program, the people who know Michael best offer clues to his complex character, sending you deep inside the mind of a man who refused to grow up. The neighbor who witnessed his industrial town youth.
Michael didn't get a chance to have a normal childhood. Michael's been working since he was 7 years old.
The reporter who's known him for 3 decades.
I actually saw the brother sort of ribbing him about his nose, and he used to call him Big Nose.
The teenage girl who pursued him.
I recall this one lady saying, "Are you going to get on birth control before you go see him?"
The beautiful dancer whom he rejected.
What did I do to deserve the treatment that I endured and the pain that I felt?
The boy who became the object of his affection.
I was 5, and my mom said, "I wonder why he doesn't have many friends his own age."
And the cameraman who captured everything on film.
He'd have a lot of parties, and that's all you would see. It's just like little kids, primarily, you know, little boys.
We will unravel the story of how Michael Jackson became a man and how the man became this.
Where else but in America could a poor black boy born in utter poverty end up being a rich white man?
VH1 News presents Michael Jackson's Secret Childhood.
Service of the warrants was part of an ongoing investigation alleging criminal misconduct on the part of Michael Jackson.
Mr. Jackson has been booked into the county jail.
Persistent allegations about his relationships with young boys.
Today, Michael Jackson stands accused of terrible crimes. Guilty or innocent, this much is true. This is a man who believes sleeping in the same bed with others' children is normal, who uses his own kids as bizarre publicity props, and who's isolated himself in a fantasy land to recapture a youth he claims he never had.
My childhood was completely taken away from me. There was no Christmas, there was no birthdays. It was not a normal childhood.
Ain't no sunshine when she's gone.
The story of Michael Jackson's secret childhood foretells the trouble he's in today. During our journey into Michael's psyche, we'll hear from friends, confidants, authors, and experts who will shed light on the mental and emotional growth of a man who was once just a boy named Mike. The path into Michael Jackson's mind begins in Gary, Indiana, the tarnished buckle on America's Rust Belt.
Gary looks like a town that's had a war. People are moving out, schools are closing, the economy is non-existent.
Michael Joseph Jackson was born on August 29, 1958, and raised in a tiny two-bedroom house behind Gary's Roosevelt High School with his mother Catherine, his father Joseph, and 8 brothers and sisters.
We bought the little house on 2300 Jackson Street, and that's where we moved in January of 1949.
The cramped house was a pressure cooker for Mike's genius and a breeding ground for family problems.
Well, the Jackson family, my impression of them was that they were poorer than the rest of us because there were so many children in that small house. And where did they sleep? That was the big mystery. Where did they all sleep?
Michael was the middle child, jammed between brothers in his quest for his parents' attention and for space in a triple-decker bunk bed.
Well, the sleeping arrangements in our home is we had triple bunk beds. Tito and I slept on the top, Michael and Marlon slept in the middle, and Jackie slept at the bottom.
The Jackson boys would share beds well into their teens at the insistence of their father, Joe. Like almost every man in Gary, Joseph Jackson worked in the steel mills.
The conditions are very bad. It was dirty. It was cruel. All you are is a number on a schedule. Do what you're told or else. This is the kind of work that Joe had to do.
Michael's father may have been a slave to the steel mill, but at 2300 Jackson Street, he ruled with an iron fist.
When I was a young reporter covering the Jacksons, I can tell you that Joseph Jackson was this fearsome character that you really didn't want to cross, and you kind of didn't even want to be in the same room with him because he was so intimidating.
Anytime I was around the Jacksons, I was struck by the fact that they called their father by his name. They called him Joe. You know, sometimes they called him Papa Joe.
He would stand out front with his arms folded, get off our lawn, and we'd scoot around the corner. And to this day, I think there's a permanent groove in that yard because of all the generations of children since they moved who have just cut the corner.
If his father, Joe, was a tyrant, Michael's mother, Kate, seemed like a saint.
Mrs. Jackson was a very gentle woman. I never saw her lose her temper. I never saw her raise her voice.
Michael was always closer to his mother than his father, partly out of wanting her protection from him.
Carol Lieberman was the first psychiatrist to file a formal child abuse complaint against Michael Jackson.
I think that he just wanted to grow up to be someone who was softer like that, as opposed to his father, who represented this tyrant.
In 1965, Katherine Jackson became a devout Jehovah's Witness, a Christian sect with strict rules against sin and a ban on childhood celebrations.
Jehovah's Witnesses are prohibited from celebrating birthdays. They are prohibited from Christmas, Halloween, even Mother's Day, Father's Day, or anything associated even with Easter if it's outside the actual commemoration of Christ's death.
At the age of 7, a wide-eyed Mike was indoctrinated into the Witnesses' world. He learned to fear the wrath of Jehovah, especially when it came to sex.
Sex outside the marriage is absolutely forbidden. That is a disfellowshipping offense. Disfellowshipped in Jehovah's Witness terminology is death. That means when Armageddon comes, you will be destroyed by God. And you're dead to everyone else in the Jehovah's Witness community, including your family and everyone that you've known.
While Michael's mother gave him a moral code to live by, Joe enforced his rules with the business end of a belt.
He was raising 6 sons, 9 children altogether. And back in the days of corporal punishment being legal, he applied it.
Children are told the expression, spare the rod, spoil the child. If you beat them with the rod, they will not die.
In raising these guys, they all got whippings. They didn't get no beatings, you know. They got whippings.
A whipping is a swat, and sometimes you would get spanked on the back.
Appropriate punishment for a child, such as spanking, which is not leaving bruises, can very quickly cross that line into physical abuse, where there are injuries.
In 2003, Michael told Martin Bashir of his childhood trauma.
You remember when you said to me that you just wanted to run away from your father?
I hid. I used to hide.
Michael has been very clear, and he insists that he was physically abused by his father, and that it was very bad and traumatic.
Joe Jackson's anger may have stemmed from his humiliation in the mills and the frustration of a musical career cut short by the needs of 9 children.
Joe ruled with an iron hand, and consequently, this has probably affected Michael the most. He probably didn't have that mental fortitude to fight back.
Michael was the most sensitive of Joe's kids and the most gifted.
When Joe would go to work, we'd just sing folk songs or sing together, but I heard him singing in the bedroom, singing one of the Temptation songs. It was so beautiful.
Every time Joe heard Michael sing, he may have been reminded of his own failure.
He was very jealous of Michael. He was the most jealous of Michael because his father really wanted to be a performer.
After school, Joe kept his sons in the house with little freedom. But when he worked the night shift, Mike and his brothers picked up Joe's abandoned guitar and with the help of neighbor Raynald Jones, jammed on the sly.
Jackson spent a lot of time inside. Those were Joseph's rules. So if I thought that it was time to practice, I could give out that whistle and they would come to the window and then we would walk over to my house.
Fearing Joe's jealous rage, the boys hid in Raynard's basement and sowed the seeds of a pop music dynasty.
Joe Jackson did not even know that we were practicing. At some point, we thought that we were ready to perform. And we wanted to go on the Roosevelt High School talent show.
7-year-old Michael's coming out party took place in 1966 at the Roosevelt High Talent Show held right behind the Jackson family home. Joe knew his boys were up to something, but instead of stepping in, he allowed them to prove their potential for profit.
We won that talent show. The crowd went wild that night. They were very impressed.
Joe Jackson was also impressed. Before, he'd whipped Tito for playing his guitar, but now he threw himself into managing the boys' careers.
We had to know that they were good. We had to know that they could win talent shows and rehearse them so they could be the best.
In the summertime, when the Jacksons would rehearse in their living room, they'd move all the furniture back, and they would open the windows, and all the neighborhood came around to stand. That's the one time Mr. Jackson didn't say anything about us being on his lawn.
Joe Jackson would soon escape the steel mills of Gary, Indiana, by riding out on the back of a boy named Mike. At the tender age of 7, Michael Jackson knew what he wanted, to be rich, famous, and free from his father, Joe.
I can remember a time when we were practicing, and I can't remember exactly what was being said, but Michael's response was, "This group will be nothing without me." Here is a kid, 7 years old, but the ironic part about it is that he probably was correct.
The roots of Michael Jackson's bizarre behavior lie in the shuttered steel mills of Gary, Indiana, and the ambition he shared with his abusive father. In 1967, Joe Jackson wanted to get out of Gary, and 9-year-old Mike wanted to make the beating stop.
Joseph was, you know, chasing him around the room saying, you know, the choreography goes that way. And Joseph would throw his shoe at him or something, and Michael would say, you know, don't, you know, if you ever throw anything at me again, I'll never sing again, another note. So don't push me.
The combination of Michael's 9-year-old ego and Joe's attacks on his son's self-esteem was explosive. Little Mike quickly became the hardest working kid in show business.
Michael as a child would always make one more spin. You know, he would run all the way to the edge of the stage, slide, stop, and just do things that were cutting edge and risky almost. Even at 5 or 6 years old, he had really been studying Jackie Wilson. He had been studying James Brown.
But not only would he move his feet like James Brown, but he'd keep on moving. And he'd keep on moving. He'd move, and you'd almost have to say, "That's enough, Mike." He wouldn't stop. He just kept dancing.
Joe Jackson stripped Michael of things most kids take for granted. Late-night gigs kept him up on school nights. Rehearsals kept him away from his friends.
And in doing so, he probably restricted some of the things, outside things, that Michael should have been enjoying as a normal boy coming up. This was an ordeal. This is something that most kids just don't do.
He pushed them, and he pushed them hard. LaToya would tell us that her brothers had performed either downtown Gary or in Chicago or somewhere the night before, and that they were really tired and they had driven all night.
I mean, we woke up singing, we went to bed singing, we rehearsed all during the day.
Joe Jackson's master plan was to get Mike as much exposure as he could, wherever he could. He booked his boys at seedy bars and strip clubs from Detroit to Chicago.
I don't know how they allowed 5 underage boys to perform in a place that served liquor and had strippers. I thought it was bizarre, but apparently Mr. Jackson was so intent on getting his boys heard, he took any gig that they were offered.
Young Michael's show business education began with an age-old lesson: sex sells.
Michael was performing at a club, and he walked right to the edge of the stage, looked right at a young lady in the audience, and started singing this romantic love song. And this young lady just really didn't know how to take it. Couldn't believe that this voice and these lyrics were coming from a child.
And he realized at a very early age that if he really wanted to please adults, you know, you had to sort of appeal to their pure inside.
But for Michael, a devout Jehovah's Witness, a conflict was brewing between doing what his father wanted and what his mother told him was God's will. Sex, ambition, and music were works of the devil, and Mike was wallowing in all three.
Jehovah's Witnesses have put forth many directives when it comes to music. If there's any reference to sex, anything that conflicts with their belief, that opens them up to Satan.
While the devil's music troubled Michael's soul, it caught the ear of Motown's Berry Gordy. In 1969, the Jacksons traded the Grey of Gary for the Sunshine of L.A., thrusting 11-year-old Mike on a stage bigger than any he'd been on before.
I would like to find out the difference between Gary, Indiana, and living in Los Angeles. You moved here now?
Yes, well, pretty sunny out here. Like it a little bit better.
Do you dig it?
Yeah, it's cold in Indiana.
Catherine Jackson knew that Michael's music violated Jehovah's law, but once she felt the warmth of Los Angeles, she wanted to get Gary as much as her husband Joe.
When we moved, it was in October, and it was really cold, and Gary and I came here, the sun was shining, birds singing, flowers in bloom, and it was like a paradise.
But along with a fairy tale life came a mandate to tell fairy tales. Catherine stood by while Motown marketeers taught her 11-year-old son to lie, beginning with his age.
Was I right? Are you 9 or 10? I've forgotten.
9.
Suddenly, 11-year-old Mike became the most precocious 9-year-old on the planet.
At first, Michael didn't understand that, and then it was explained, well, this is public relations, and it's not a lie if you're talking about your image.
Well...
And this little boy grasped on to that idea that it's okay to tell a lie if it's called public relations.
In 1970, Michael Jackson was lead singer of the hottest bubblegum band in America, and his childhood was officially over.
The older siblings all had normal lives, at least up until the teens, whereas Michael had no childhood.
There's no childhood at all. I mean, it's full-time professional performing.
In L.A., Michael tried to go to school like a normal kid, but his fame got in the way.
He did perform for us on the table. He danced and sang on the table at our, was it graduation or Christmas or something?
At the age of 12, Michael's last best chance to socialize with children his own age was taken away. He would never graduate from high school, never go to a prom, never earn a college degree. He entered a world of private tutors and full-time performance.
Most biographers of Mozart and child prodigies will tell you they don't have a lot of social graces, because where do you learn it? Around your peers and in classrooms. That's where you learn social skills. But Michael did not have child peers.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Jackson Five.
All right.
Michael's formal schooling may have ended, but his sexual education had just begun. After Jackson 5 concerts, Mike and his brother Marlon hit the sack, while the older boys hit the jackpot.
Michael and Marlon were still little kids, but Jermaine and Jackie and Tito, you know, they were older, and they had become teen idols, and they had a lot of groupies.
Jackie's wife, Enid, actually told me that when they were teenagers, they'd have a bunch of women just up in the room.
The boys would have sex with the groupies while Michael and Marlon were in bed, you know, acting as if they were sleeping when actually they were listening or maybe even watching.
I think that's the cleaned up version of what Enid told me.
While the older Jacksons considered it good, clean fun, for Michael, the group gropes had lasting effects. Not only did Joe Jackson condone his son's sexual escapades, he did them one better, or worse. According to Michael's brother Marlon, late at night, Joe Jackson would sneak girls into the boys' room and show off his sons, but the price of admission was steep.
Joseph wanted to show some of these young ladies that he was a family man, you know, that, you know, they're my kids and they're famous and I did that and now I'm going to do you.
Joseph warned his boys not to tell their mother about his secret, and no matter how much Michael may have wanted to expose his dad, for the young Jehovah's Witness, his father's word was gospel.
A key scripture that's read over and over again is to honor your father and your mother. If a child was to question their parent or not submit to their direction, then it could be viewed as a sin against God. And so it creates this atmosphere that it's best just to stay quiet.
Michael was torn. Disobey his dad and his God, or lie to his beloved mother. It was an impossible choice.
Especially for Michael, because he was so tremendously sensitive, to have that experience on the road and then go back to their God-fearing mother and, you know, not be honest with her. I mean, there was this dual thing going on in Michael Jackson's life from a very early age.
In the end, Michael chose to protect his abusive father and lie to the one woman he trusted, his mother, Kate.
And when they come home off a tour, and they'd be gone about a month or so, we'd just make a big dinner for them, like a celebration, when they were coming home.
Michael's guilty conscience may have been eased by the lessons of Motown. A lie isn't a lie if it helps your career.
Well,
I think he had some sense, even at that young age, that if he did tell this secret and it did destroy his family, it might well destroy his chance of becoming a star.
By 1972, Michael Jackson was a deeply confused 14-year-old.
It desensitized him to the importance of sexuality in your life. He became really, in my view, asexual.
The change in was profound. As a child, he was a precocious flirt with an angel's face and charisma to spare.
Are you shy?
No.
You know, it's very difficult. What's with the O's and the R's? There's a few girls over there who want to take you home with them, and who knows?
Michael always seemed to be very fond of women. He was a little charmer. There was nothing strange about Michael. There was nothing weird about Michael.
Kept flirting with these girls, pointing at them and winking at them and, you know, trying to get them to come down front and say hello.
But at an age when most teens crave puppy love, Mike seemed to fear the female touch. And the more he shied away from girls, the more frenzied the fans became.
I think that girls represented, you know, having my hair pulled, represented someone screaming suddenly at the top of their lungs. You know, just suddenly screaming.
Fans will be hanging around. We'll hear a knock on the door and say, room service. We open the door.
It's what rock stars go through, though. Most of the guys like it. You never heard Jermaine complaining about it. You never heard Jackie complaining about it, but Michael didn't. Michael didn't like to be touched and handled and pulled at, and oh, he really hated it. He just really hated it.
Behind the scenes, God-fearing Catherine tried to guide her sensitive son.
There were fans who had sort of special status. You would write a letter to Michael Jackson, and you'd actually get a response, or you get a phone call from Catherine saying, you know what, why don't you come to Las Vegas and hang out with us?
I was in the seventh grade, and I just was in love with him. So I started writing him letters every day, and in 1974, he's going to be in Las Vegas for my 16th birthday.
In 1974, Catherine Jackson arranged a date between Michael and Teresa Gonsalves, a 16-year-old fan from Boston, even though Teresa's presence violated Jehovah's rules.
Teenagers are only allowed to date if they're ready to get married. So if a person wants to date someone and they say, I just want to have fun, that is strictly forbidden in church literature. Even a telephone conversation was a date, and they could find themselves disfellowshipped. So you have this fear, this actual fear of experiencing death.
The older Jackson boys seemed to sense Michael was afraid of girls. So after a show at the MGM Grand, they playfully pushed him on Teresa.
One holding me and, you know, one brother holding him, holding Michael, and just trying to make us kiss. Here, kiss her, kiss her. And we're both, you know, putting our heads down and trying to stop it. And we ended up in a room together, and it was just me and him. And that's when we had our first one-on-one.
But when it was time to make a move, 15-year-old Mike resisted temptation.
I'm sitting down about 2 feet away from him. And I'm shy, he's shy, who's gonna start this conversation? So finally, Michael began the conversation by saying, do you believe in the devil? And that just kind of scared me. I was like, where is he going with this? And that's how he started witnessing to me. He discussed the Jehovah's Witness religion with me for about an hour. And he showed me, he had his Jehovah's Witness books and stuff. The amazing thing to me was, when I got home the next day, Jehovah's Witnesses rang my bell.
As Michael grew older, his distaste for sex was perceived in a different way. When he pushed girls away, members of the press pushed back, speculating on his lack of female friends.
You would, you know, be told by your editor, you gotta ask him if he's gay. And you're like, what? I mean, how are you gonna ask Michael Jackson if he's gay?
I asked him about the rumor that he was gay. And he looked at me and he said, you know what I need you to do? I need you to turn off that tape recorder. And I said, okay. And he said, no, I'm not gay. And I said, well, why did you ask me to turn off the tape recorder? And he said, well, because I know that we have many fans who are gay. And I don't want to offend any of these people.
Imagine that when you're a kid. I mean, imagine. And you don't even want to address those issues with your family members, let alone a guy like me sitting across from you in a baseball cap saying, so listen, dude, are you gay? None of us ever thought Michael was going to turn out to be, you know, as conflicted as he is.
Hounded by reporters and tormented by his family, late in 1974, a lonely and confused Michael turned to those who seemed most like him, little boys.
I met Michael back in the early 70s at the American Music Awards.
The very first in Michael's long line of young male companions was adorable hamburger spokes kid, Rodney Allen Rippey. They met when Michael was 16, Rodney was 5.
You know, I'm like, well, can we be friends? He's like, sure, we can be friends. I'm like, can I give you my number? He's like, sure, you can. You want my number? I'm like, yeah. Michael used to call my house every single Saturday and talk to me on the phone. My mom wondered, said, you know, I wonder why he doesn't have many friends his own age, you know.
In 1976, there were two Michael Jacksons, the seasoned performer and the awkward 18-year-old. Uninterested in women, intrigued by little boys, and in constant fear of offending God. Michael was a prisoner of his own psyche. The only place he felt free was on stage.
Do you remember any time in your whole life when you weren't performing?
Well, not really.
No.
We've always performed.
Yeah.
And he once said to me, he said, you don't understand, I was a star at 6. And I do not feel alive unless I'm performing or I'm making a record. There is nothing else.
I
no performing.
But that's not...
It looks like it's people on stage.
But that's not Michael Jackson, the person.
After a decade of being jealously guarded by his father and educated by tutors, Michael was a boy in a bubble. At an age when most young men were thinking of college, he had the mindset of a child.
He didn't know who was president of the United States, didn't know anything about, you know, the government or how the country was run.
I remember him telling me, listen, I've been all around the world, but as a child, I never saw any of these places. Chicago looked the same as Dallas to me.
In my life, I really had one vacation, and that was last Christmas. Outside of that, let me think what I did. I just stayed home. I watched television. I read a lot.
I think the effect of being on the road that way created a very lonely person.
When Michael turned 19, fate struck in the form of Diana Ross. Once Mike's Motown mentor, Diana was now in New York, starring in a film called The Wiz, and she wanted her protege to join the cast.
The first time Michael really had a chance to stretch out and be on his own was when he went to New York to do The Wiz.
Michael had never before been away from his family, but in 1977 he tore himself from their grip. Joe reluctantly let him go, but on one condition.
Of course, you know, they sent LaToya with him, but at least I let him go.
In New York, Michael was finally free from his abusive father and suffocating brothers. It was also the first time he'd been away from his beloved mother and the all-seeing eyes of the Jehovah's Witnesses.
When you have that strict environment, it creates a group of kids that lead what Jehovah's Witnesses call double lives. The Jehovah's Witness life, and then the other life when they get away from those within the church. Sex, drugs, and rock and roll, you know? And when you've been completely repressed, if you've never had a date, till you're 18, it's hard to resist.
The first test of Michael's faith took place at New York's version of Sodom and Gomorrah, Studio 54. He felt at home among the disco's star-studded clientele and was fascinated by its vices.
People doing lots of drugs. I mean, lots of drugs. And upstairs was unprotected, promiscuous sex.
Celebrity photographer Vinny Zafante shadowed Michael during his New York days. But at Studio 54, Vinny never saw Michael partake in the partying. Instead, he liked to watch and gossip with a posse of disco queens.
He had Andy Warhol one side, Liza on the other, Liz Taylor one side, Betty Ford on the other. But I never saw him upstairs or downstairs. I never saw him with a drink.
Everybody has a thing. Everybody's got one. It wasn't his thing.
Another temptation Michael encountered in Manhattan was his old friend Teresa Gonsalves, once his shy pen pal. But by 1977, she'd come of age.
Forget about this 16-year-old in Vegas. He's a young man, I'm a young woman. I'm no longer the virgin, he knew.
Teresa came to visit Michael in New York, but unlike their arranged date in Las Vegas 4 years earlier, this time 20-year-old Teresa took control.
We were just in the room alone, and we were just close enough at that point to kiss, just about to kiss, and LaToya came in the room.
When LaToya interrupted Teresa's pass, Michael seemed relieved. The reason gave Teresa an unexpected glimpse into Michael's tortured soul. Michael told Teresa a secret, that a trauma in his past prevented him from sharing himself romantically with anyone.
It was no names. It was just not a good time in his life. He wasn't interested in anyone, you know, not anyone. He was just in his own little world.
Though Teresa suspected Mike had more to admit, she would never learn the details of his despair. In New York, Michael had a chance to become a different man. But instead of seeking help, his abused inner child seemed to go deeper underground, determined not to let his pain stand in the way of the 20-year-old pop star's success. It was a choice that would haunt Michael's adulthood.
A lot of times when children are abused, they separate themselves, they dissociate themselves from themselves. There's a way of surviving, but later on it can become a more serious problem.
In 1978, the strength of Michael's psyche would be tested. Soon he'd be on a plane back to LA, back to his old room, his old life, and the same old father, Joe.
A lot of people think I'm really, really mean. The problem is they don't know me.
20-year-old Michael Jackson left New York full of hope. He had proved to himself that he could live apart from the suffocating grasp of his father and proved to God that he could resist temptation. Michael buried the pain of his childhood deep inside and returned to LA, determined to become bigger than the Jackson 5.
He had become a man. This was the cat who was running the show.
Michael had this concept of becoming the biggest star on the planet. And Michael wanted his own lawyers. Michael wanted his own managers. Michael wanted his own record deal.
We're honoring Michael tonight for the phenomenal success he enjoys around the world.
At Epic Records, Walter Yetnikoff convinced Michael that solo success was his best revenge against Joe.
He once said to me, you know, I've accomplished a lot, and my father has never told me that he's proud of me. And I became daddy, and I said, come here, Michael, let me give you a hug, and let me tell you how proud everyone in the pop music field is of you, and the fact is you are the number one pop star in the entire world.
By 1980, Michael's Off the Wall album had made him millions. He used his fortune to buy Havenhurst, the Jackson's mansion. Joe got the cash, and Michael got to rebuild his childhood from scratch.
When the son suddenly owns the house that the father is living in, things change a lot.
This was the house that Off the Wall built. It was everything that Mike wanted in a house.
If somebody had the means to recreate a childhood, you could create a childlike environment and be like a kid in a candy store. Does it really help that emptiness inside? Unfortunately, it does not.
Michael's desperate vision included everything he never had in Gary, Indiana. And instead of being crammed into a triple bunk bed, he built his own wing.
Woo-hoo. Oh, man, what are you guys telling me you were shooting? I'll be right down. One sec, okay?
It was always a lot of fun going up there, though, because you never knew what you were going to see. You never knew what, you know, wacky Disney character was going to maybe meet you at the gate.
If the first step in Michael's delusional spending spree was to create a dream version of 2300 Jackson Street, the next was to fill it with the playmates he was denied as a child. Cameraman Steve Howell took these rare home movies of Michael's new best friends.
All of a sudden, these three vans drive up, and next thing you know, what the? There's the seven dwarfs, you know, like you would see at Disneyland, are getting out of the van, and they frolic into his house. At that time, I'm going, this is too wild. The water fountain that's in front of his house is actually his wishing well. So they all went out there and they were doing their little, you know, wish. Michael always said, you know, capture the magic. So I was capturing the magic on film.
As a child, Michael shared pets with his siblings. But in his reinvented youth, Mike populated his suburban palace with a Noah's Ark all of his own.
Everything went upscale, man. You know, you went from having a regular old German Shepherd to having an exotic chimp hanging around the joint that wore clothes.
Mr. Tibbs was the ram. Louis the llama.
He's a charming, sweet animal. Hi, Louis. Let me see your beautiful ears.
You would see giraffes and you know, the neighbors were always very upset because it smelled bad up there. It did. You know, it's not a zoo. It's somebody's home and Encino.
With his millions, Michael could finally buy Katherine Jackson the happiness he thought she deserved. So in 1984, he threw his mother the birthday party of her dreams. Although Michael's generosity was angelic, Catherine's party violated a Jehovah's Witness taboo.
You're going, wait a minute, I thought that Jehovah's Witnesses never celebrated birthdays.
That's absolutely stunning as far as I'm concerned. If a person celebrates a birthday, they face sanction because they are doing something that's associated with pagan origins.
Catherine soothed her son's guilt by insisting her presents be brown paper bags. While she had long ago learned to bend the witnesses' rules when it came to the finer things in life, this was the first time Michael had dared to deceive Jehovah.
Not having those gifts unless they're wrapped in brown paper is similar to the idea of it being okay to lie if it's for your image and public relations.
Well,
Michael's grip on the truth was completely coming loose. And when he finished rebuilding Havenhurst, he set out on an even more ambitious course by reinventing Michael Jackson.
I can only tell you what I know and what I heard and what he told me. That one was, I would like to separate myself from the Jackson 5 and become me, Michael Jackson. So in that separation, he changed himself.
He had a song called Man in the Mirror, Change. And he, that's what he tried to do. He tried to change. He tried to change what he saw in the mirror. Because he obviously didn't like himself, even though he was a big star.
In the real world, Michael was one of five singing brothers in a poor black family. But in the lie he told himself, he was Peter Pan, an androgynous orphan from a lily-white fairyland. Step one in Michael's transformation was to streamline the feature that reminded him most of his father.
I actually saw the brother sort of ribbing him about his nose, and he used to call him Big Nose, and I asked Joe about it. What about Michael's nose? And Joe said, you know, he's got a great nose. His nose is just like mine, and he should be proud of his nose.
After claiming that he broke his nose in an onstage fall, Michael spent the early 1980s chipping away at the link to his father.
I saw really fine stitches on the sides of his nose.
You're saying you've only ever had one piece of surgery on your nose?
Two.
You've had two?
As his face took on an elfin shape, Michael's skin also got lighter in tone. He claimed to have a skin disease that turned him from black to white.
They said I was putting on cream to make myself white. Is that true?
I try to talk to him a couple of times. You don't need to change your color. No one knows what color you are. No one cares. You're Michael Jackson. You're a pop icon. You don't have to do this. He wouldn't respond. He would just turn his head. He would just look the other way. He wouldn't pay any attention.
And while his singing voice was always high, his speaking tone suddenly became a childish whisper.
The Michael that I've always heard had, you know, a fairly deep speaking tone.
Can we try it just one more time? Then we'll take it from the top.
I hope he doesn't get angry at me for telling you this, but that's his public persona. I remember a time I called him up and he answered the phone and I didn't know I was talking to him because he was talking in his normal voice, which is pretty deep.
By 1984, Michael Jackson was living his fantasy full-time, but his quest to become the little boy of his dreams had one fatal flaw, because after all the pain and expense, the new improved Michael still lived under the same roof as his father. No matter how much he spent, there was no way Michael could escape Joe's grasp. Whatever happened in that tiny house back in Gary formed a bond stronger than his urge to flee from the man he despised, yet couldn't live without.
Children who have been abused, because they don't want to believe that they weren't loved by their abuser, they make up all these excuses. Well, this person was really showing me love.
But he's a genius. The man is a genius. The same time he was a genius. He really is.
But Michael, he injured you when you were a child.
Yeah, but look what came out of him.
Between 1978 and 1984 saw the emergence of a new Michael Jackson. He went from a shy teen with dreams of a solo career to a brash 25-year-old with delusions of grandeur on a scale never seen before.
From the ashes of kid star Michael came this different Michael.
I could not have a conversation with him which did not revolve around Michael Jackson and his records and his shows and how wonderful he was.
Michael's millions had allowed him to rewrite his history and reinvent himself. But behind the shades and sequin glove, he was still a lonely soul. Michael's options for companionship were few. As a boy, he was scarred by his abusive father's infidelity and scared celibate by the Jehovah's Witnesses. And if he were gay, both his heavenly father and his earthly mother would never allow it.
Homosexuality is strictly forbidden within the church. There's no coming out. It's not accepted, and you can't do it, and you got to be celibate.
Not gay, and this is, I don't know why they keep writing that. It's, I guess it could be because you wear makeup, but when you're on stage, everyone wears makeup.
Michael tried to convince the world he was Peter Pan, a little boy who never grew up. So it seemed logical that his ideal companions would be as innocent as his persona appeared to be.
I haven't been betrayed or deceived by children. Adults have let me down. Adults have let the world down.
But Michael also coped with his traumatic youth by lying to his God and himself. The true motives for his bizarre interest in children were a mystery, maybe even to Michael.
Whether one has been the victim, which is the child abuse survivor, or the victimizer, both parties could be attracted to situations where other children are around.
Michael's fascination with young boys surfaced in 1974 with pint-sized celebrity Rodney Allen Rippey.
He would call me and he was interested in what was going on in my little world, you know. And when the Off the Wall album hit, I lost contact with him.
Just after Off the Wall was released in 1979, Michael met Terry George, a lonely English school kid. Just as with Rodney, 20-year-old Michael reached out to 12-year-old Terry by phone.
What is your name?
Michael Jackson.
And what is your job?
I'm a singer.
What do you like most? Things that you like?
Oh, my kids like.
But on the BBC documentary Louis, Martin and Michael, an adult Terry admitted that one of Michael's calls went too far.
But in 1993, two papers ran the story that Michael had been masturbating during one of their phone calls.
Parts of the story are true. I would say majority of it's true. It's quite unfortunate, really, that somebody wants to focus on a 10-second part of a conversation, well, 3-minute part of a conversation.
In 1983, Michael turned to 12-year-old Emmanuel Lewis, a TV star who appeared much younger. In public, 25-year-old Michael claimed he saw something of himself in Emmanuel.
Because he was a young kid, he was thrown into this business, and he wanted to show him a different way.
Though he lived at Havenhurst, Michael kept a penthouse apartment in Los Angeles as a secret hideout to escape his family and fans. Steve Howell was there when Mike brought Emmanuel over to play.
One day, I captured the moment of them dancing together up at the penthouse to one of Michael's new songs, Michael dancing and Emmanuel dancing, doing the moonwalk and standing up on his toes like Mike would do.
At the same time Michael befriended Emmanuel, he was pursued by teen star Brooke Shields. Michael endured Brooke's aggressive courtship because he knew it would keep him in the headlines.
Brooke Shields in the late 1970s and early 1980s is huge. She is the model. I mean, she was the face of Calvin Klein, or was the rear end of Calvin Klein, whichever.
We have a lot of fun because we just joke like we're in, I don't know, kindergarten or something.
Brooke was very aggressive with him, you know, as far as trying to tongue kiss and all that kind of stuff. At that point in life, he really wasn't all that into it.
In 1984, Brooke bullied her way onto Michael's arm at the American Music Awards. She may have been his date, but Emmanuel was the object of his affection.
He literally toted Emmanuel Lewis up to him with his awards, because Emmanuel Lewis was very totable. He's small.
An important chemistry and writing song is Inspiration, and I'm holding one of my inspirations is Emmanuel Lewis.
Michael's adoring public didn't think twice when it saw him with his prepubescent pal.
Jackson is already well into his mid-20s, and if, you know, that isn't setting off alarm bells, that this is not quite right.
As Michael's passion for children grew, his own behavior became more childlike. The combination of his changing appearance and immature antics gave rise to tabloid stories that he'd gone off the deep end.
Michael turned to me, and this is true, and he said, "Walter, I have to tinkle. Can you take me to the potty?" I mean, I might say, I have to go to the bathroom. Where is it? But it's a different way of saying it. It was saying, like a little kid, "Can you take me?"
Any sign of an adult relationship may have quelled rumors about Michael's unusual interest in children. So, in 1987, Michael's mother came to his rescue, just as she'd set up her son with Teresa Gonsalves 13 years earlier. Catherine Jackson pinned her hopes on Tatiana Thompson, a dancer with stars in her eyes.
Mrs. J told me that Michael spoke to her during the video one morning and expressed his love for me.
The video was for Michael's song, "The Way You Make Me Feel." Tatiana played a damsel in distress and Michael a cad with a crush. Despite their on-screen chemistry, Tatiana was mystified by Michael's method of telling her the way he felt.
I mean, if he's so crazy about me and this guy's in love with me, why doesn't he call me? Why doesn't he tell me or express, you know, his feelings to me? Why is everyone else telling me but him?
But when Tatiana acted on the information Catherine had given her, she came face to face with the enigma that Michael Jackson had become.
I had been invited on tour with Michael, and I took it upon myself to kind of change the routine a bit. Something just came over me. And then I looked into Michael's eyes, and he did the sexiest thing. He bit his bottom lip. It was like, you know, it was kind of like he was challenging me, like, come on. You know, show me what you got. And the next thing I know, we're locked in a kiss, and his hands were on my hip. I remember backstage, when I ran into his mother, Catherine, she greeted me with the warmest hug. The next person, that's pain I'll never forget. His manager, Frank DeLeo, gave me the most evil look. And that was it. I was off the tour.
Tatiana found out the hard way about the demons that drove Michael Jackson. For years, Michael's mother had manipulated his love life, but now Michael had a chance to make a choice all of his own.
I had gone to his trailer to try and talk to him. And I stood there with Ricky Schroeder and Alfonso Ribeiro, and they went in to see Michael. And I stood up, waiting. And I never spoke to Michael again.
By the time Thriller was honored with 9 Grammys in 1984, little Michael Jackson from Gary, Indiana, had achieved his boyhood dream and much, much more.
Where else but in America could a poor black boy born in utter poverty in Gary, Indiana, end up being a rich white man? Only in America.
Michael's failed marriages and single fatherhood were far in the future. The first allegations of child abuse against him were years away.
There have been many disgusting statements made recently concerning allegations of improper conduct on my part. These statements about me are totally false.
In 1984, Michael was still basking in the glow of a new face, a new life, a new history. But all the hype couldn't chase the demons that must have haunted his dreams.
Success, fame, and fortune, they're all illusions. That's beautiful. Who said that? I did.
At the age of 26, Michael was an emotionally crippled young man.
I used to be very lonely, painful.
Living in a fantasy land of his own creation.
I like a lot of fantasy, and that's what I try to create. It's a good way to become moved. To become moved.
And living a life rife with contradictions.
I think kids are very special. Their eyes, their face, their expression, their characters. Magic.
By the mid-1980s, Michael's unusual interest in little boys was plain for all to see. Yet few questioned the motives of a man who was worshipped by so many.
He'd have a lot of parties, disadvantaged kids and boys, and that's all you would see. It's just like little kids, primarily, you know, little boys.
Michael's access to kids was fueled by his fortune and enabled by his family and friends, many of whom had a financial stake in his success.
Everyone is saying yes around you. When everybody wants you to win for their own particular reasons, then, you know, you tend to believe that, hey, maybe I can levitate, you know?
Some friends cautioned Michael about his behavior, but the stubborn child still lived inside the man.
I know a lot of people were telling him, stay away, stay away, stay away.
People have tried to tell him along the way, don't do that. You'll be sorry if you continue to do this. And Michael is just saying, don't tell me what to do. No one ever tells me what to do. And guess what? I'm having even more 14-year-olds over. I mean, Michael's always had this side of him.
An abusive father, a strict religious upbringing, sexual confusion, money, power, fame. The twisted path of Michael Jackson's development is a psychological minefield. Whether it has turned a victim into a victimizer, a man into a monster, is still a mystery. But clues can be found in Michael's secret childhood and the choices he made along the way.
Soaring up so high.